Hello everyone, welcome to Teaching Pathshala. This is the 15th part of phytohormone in which we are going to study about the ethylene signaling pathway. This topic will be beneficial for all the students who are preparing for the CSIR NET, GATE Life Science and the students who are pursuing in MSc and the BSc courses. In the end of this video, we are going to discuss a question regarding this topic. The students who have not seen rest of the part of this phytohormone, for them I will mention the link in the last of this video. First of all, we are going to talk about the component of signaling pathway. That means what are the different players are there which are playing their important role during the signaling pathway. So the first thing which used to come in our mind is the signaling molecule or the ligand. So the role of ligand is going to be played by a ethylene phytohormone. And the receptor role or the receptor is going to be the ETR1. And the full form of this ETR1 is the ethylene response 1. The important property of ethylene receptor is it is a copper ion based receptor which used to do proper function in the presence of a copper. That means there should be a copper if you want to see the proper functioning of an ethylene receptor. So as because it is a copper ion, so there should be any kind of a transporter that will going to help in the transportation of this copper ion on the surface of a receptor. So the role of this copper ion transporter is going to be played by a RAN1 or the RAN1. So it is a transporter of a copper ion that will going to help the transportation of a copper to the ethylene receptor surface. Next point is about the location of this receptor, okay, that is the ETR1. So the location of this receptor is a ER membrane, but the receiver domain or the receiver part of this receptor is going to be present at the ER lumen side. The regulators which are going to play a very important role in this pathway are the ETR1, ERF1, CTR1, EIN2 and EIN3. And if you talk about the signaling pathway of the ethylene, then it also used to follow the two component signaling pathway system, just like the pathway system which we used to see in our bacterial system. The next most important point regarding the component of signaling pathway is that the receptor are the negative regulator because binding of the ethylene inactivates the receptor. In rest of the part of signaling pathway that was related to the phytohormone, we have seen that after the binding of a particular ligand or phytohormone to its respective receptor, the overall like receptor is supposed to be activated. But this is the exceptional case or exceptional pathway in which the binding of a ligand to a receptor is causing the deactivation or inactivation of that receptor. And that is why we are saying that the receptor for this ethylene pathway is supposed to be a negative regulator. In the previous video, we have talked about the receptor and the name of that receptor is the ETR1. So apart from that one receptor, there are more few receptors that has been identified in our Arabidopsis, as well as it has been seen that they used to give a like positive response toward the ethylene signaling pathway, or they used to play an important role in a ethylene signaling pathway. So these receptors are, first is the ETR1, the full form is the ethylene response 1. The second receptor is the ETR2, that is the ethylene response 2. Third is the EIN4, that is the ethylene insensitive 4. Fourth is the ERS1, that is the ethylene response sensor 1. And fifth is the ERS2, that is the ethylene response sensor 2. So apart from ETR1, there are more four receptors that is going to be present in our Arabidopsis plant. Now we are going to start with the ethylene signaling pathway. And the first case about which we are going to talk about is the absence of ethylene. So what happened actually, as you know that the location of this ethylene receptor is that the ETR1 is in a ER and the receiver part is going to be present in the ER lumen. And this receptor is going to have a histidine kinase domain, that is the ETR1 is going to have a histidine kinase domain because this is going to follow the two component signaling pathway that I have already discussed when I was explaining all the different thing that is the phosphorylase system in a cytokinin signaling pathway. So overall the basic procedure will be same, just like first of all the histidine domain is supposed to be a phosphorylated, then it is going to pass or the phosphorylate the aspartate domain. So all this pathway or all this like mode of action is supposed to be same just like the cytokinin, but the overall pathway is going to be changed. So the signaling pathway will be same, that will be related to the histidine kinase domain. So what happened, the RAN1, which is a transporter of a copper ion, that RA1 is going to transport the copper ion to the surface of a receptor, and after binding to the receptor, the overall like this histidine kinase of the ETR1 is going to be autophosphorylated, and after the autophosphorylation it is going to phosphorylate the receiver domain of a receptor, fine, that is the D, that D is representing the aspartate amino acid. So after the autophosphorylation, there will be a phosphorylation of a receiver domain, and that you can see from the figure. And after that, what happened? They are going to, like, after the phosphorylation event, they are going to activate the CTR1 protein. The full form of CTR1 is the constitutive triple response 1. So this protein is supposed to be activated with the help of a phosphorylation that has been performed by the histidine kinase domain of the ETR1 receptor. After the activation of a CTR1 with the phosphorylation event, now this CTR1 is going to phosphorylate the EIN2 cytoplasmic domain. This EIN2 is an important transmembrane protein that is going to be present or located in a ER membrane. Along with that, it is going to have a transmembrane domain as well as a C-end domain, or the C-end. So what happened actually, the CTR1 protein is going to phosphorylate this C-end of a EIN2 protein. Now the phosphorylation of a C-end of a EIN2 will going to activate the ETP1 protein. The full form of this ETP1 protein is the EIN2 targeting protein. And this ETP1 protein is a F-box protein, which is going to cause the ubiquitination of this EIN2 and make it to a degradation by a 26S proteasome degradation pathway. So after the phosphorylation of a C end of a EIN2, it is itself is activating the F-box protein, which will going to lead to a degradation of this EIN2 protein. In actual, this EIN2 is a very important transmembrane protein, which is supposed to be stabilize the EIN3 transcription factor, which used to present in the nucleus. But as because the degradation of this EIN2 has been taken place, so there is no one to stabilize the EIN3 transcription factor that is supposed to be present inside a nucleus. And the property of this EIN3 is that it used to remain bound with the 26S proteasome degradation complex. So as because there is no one to stabilize this EIN3, the ubiquitination and the proteasomal degradation will going to take place with this EIN3, and as a result there will be a degradation of this EIN3, which is supposed to be a important transcription factor in this signaling pathway of a ethylene. So previously in the nucleus, EIN3 was attached to the 26S proteasome degradation complex. So as because there is an absence of a EIN2, so that will lead to the degradation of a EIN3 in a nucleus. And as a result, there will be a no transcription of a ethylene responsive genes. So we have completed with the first case in which we have seen that what is going to happen when there is a no ethylene. Fine. In the second case, we are going to talk about that what happened during the presence of a ethylene. In the presence of a ethylene, what happened? The ethylene is going to bind to the ETR1 receptor, and this in turn is going to switch off the overall activity of this receptor, and that is what called the negative regulation. Because in normal cases, when there is a binding of a ligand to a receptor, there is an activation of that receptor. But in this case, the binding of the ligand, that is the ethylene, will going to lead to the inactivation of the ETR1 receptor, which is a receptor of the ethylene signaling pathway. As because there is an inactivation of a receptor, so as a result, there will be the absence of an autophosphorylation in the histidine kinase domain. And as a result, there will be a no phosphorylation in the CTR1 protein. So as because CTR1 protein is not phosphorylated, then it is not going to phosphorylate the C end of a EIN2 transmembrane protein. So due to the absence of phosphorylation, or you can say that due to the presence of a dephosphorylation, there will be a cleavage of the C end of a EIN2. And now the C end is going to be free from the transmembrane domain of a EIN2. Now this C end of a EIN2 is going to make a translocation to a nucleus, and as a result, it is going to stabilize the EIN3, which is going to be present inside a nucleus. So after stabilizing this EIN3 is supposed to get released from the proteasomal complex. So in this way, the degradation pathway will going to be inhibited. So there will be a no degradation of a EIN3, because the EIN2 has been stabilizes this transcription factor, and as a result, this EIN3 has been released from this proteasomal complex. So what happened after that? The EIN3 make a transcription of a different ethylene responsive gene by activating the intermediate one more transcription factor, that is the ERF1. This ERF1 is going to play a role of the promoter of a gene, and the full form of this ERF1 is the ethylene response factor 1. The EIN3 and ERF1 both are supposed to be termed as a transcription factor for the ethylene responsive genes. So you have to remember the both, that is the unbound state of a ETR as well as the bound state of a ETR, that how in a binded form how the ETR is going to behave, and if there is an absence of a ethylene or the unbounded form of a ETR, then how it is behaving. So if you want to summarize the whole pathway, then in the absence of a ethylene, the ETR1 and the other ethylene receptor activate the kinase activity of the CTR1 protein. Fine. So this lead to a repression of a ethylene response pathway, possibly through a MAP kinase pathway. The binding of the ethylene to the ETR1 dimer result in its inactivation, which causes the CTR1 to become inactive. And this you should remember, that the receptor is supposed to be a dimer receptor. Fine. The next point will be the inactivation of the CTR is going to allow the transmembrane protein, that is the EIN2, to become active. And after the activation, there will be a cleavage of the C end of a EIN2. In this way, the activation of a EIN2 in turns on the EIN3 family of a transcription factor, which in turns induce the expression of a ERF1 transcription factor. And as a result, the activation of this transcription cascade is going to make a transcription of our ethylene responsive gene, and as a result we are going to see the ethylene mediated response in our plant. This ethylene responsive gene is going to play a very important role in different kind of a functions, like the stromal guard cell function, then it may be a regulation of a cell division, it may be a defense in a pathogen attack, and any kind of a abiotic stress. The one more information about the CTR1, which is the constitutive triple response 1 gene, or you may say it as a protein. So it is a RAF-like serine threonine kinase. The active form of a CTR1 stimulates the ubiquitination and the degradation of a nuclear gene regulatory protein, which is called the EIN3. Now let's see one question from CSIRnet 2015 December. So the question is, ethylene is an important plant hormone that regulates the several aspects of plant growth and development. Some statements are given below in relation to a ethylene signaling pathway. So in last statement, they have mentioned that the which combination of the above statement is the correct one. So you have to choose total of a two correct statement, and then you have to mark a correct answer. Let's move with the first statement, or the A statement. So they have mentioned that the unbound ethylene receptor work as the positive regulator of a response pathway. So first of all, the unbound ethylene response means when there is an absence of a ethylene. Fine. So there will be a no binding of a ethylene with a receptor. So as a result, there will be a no regulation, or the no regulation in the ethylene signaling pathway. But they have mentioned that it is supposed to work as the positive regulator of the response pathway. No. Somehow it is going to activate the different genes like the CTR1, but finally it is not going to make a regulation in the response pathway. That simply means that it is not going to activate the overall signaling pathway of a ethylene. Fine. So in the absence of a ethylene, somehow the receptor is supposed to activate, but after the activation of a receptor, it is not going to activate the whole pathway. That is why it is regarded as the negative regulator, not the positive regulator. So in this way, the unbounded ethylene receptor is never going to positively regulate the overall ethylene signaling pathway. So this statement is totally wrong. And if you see the overall combination of a statement, so in the first option and in the last option, there is a presence of A. So we can easily able to eliminate the first and the fourth option. And now we are left with only two options, that is the option number 2 and option number 3. Now let's move to the B statement. There are more than 2 ethylene receptors known to date. Obviously, there are more than 2, like we have seen total of 5, I think, ethylene receptor, and they have already mentioned that there are more than 2 ethylene receptor known to be dead. So this statement is totally correct. So again, if you want to do elimination method, then if you see the overall option, so we are only left with the second and the third option. So as because we are 100% confirmed about the B option, and if you see the overall option combination, so only the second option is supposed to show the presence of a B. Fine. So this is an indication that might be the second answer will going to be the option number 2. But somehow we are going to deal with the C and the D statements too. In the C statement, they have mentioned that the carboxyl terminal half of the ethylene receptor, the ETR1, which is the ethylene response 1, contain a domain homologous to a histidine kinase catalytic domain. So this statement is totally correct, because we have already seen when we were studying about the signaling pathway that there is a presence of a histidine kinase domain at the C terminal of a ETR1. So with this, we have confirmed that the C statement is also true. So if you see the option, there is a second option which is going to have a combination of a B and C. So the correct answer is the option number 2. But somehow we have to see that why we have eliminated the D option. So in D statement, they have told that the EIN2, which is the ethylene insensitive 2, encode a transmembrane protein. The EIN2 mutation promote the ethylene responses in both seedling and the adult Arabidopsis plant. So in this statement, they have talked about the EIN2, which is a transmembrane protein. Fine. So this EIN2 gene is supposed to encode a protein, which is the EIN2 itself. But what happened when there is a mutation in the EIN2? So let's see. First of all, if there is a mutation in the EIN2, the overall normal functioning of this EIN2 is supposed to be get disturbed, okay? So somehow it is going to behave in same way as it was behaving in the absence of a ethylene. That means it is not going to take part in the positive way, fine. It is not going to make a regulation in the overall different type of function that was supposed to be controlled by the ethylene signaling pathway. So it is not going to make a response in seedling or any kind of a adult Arabidopsis plant because this is now mutated. So this is not going to stabilize the EIN3 transcription factor. Fine. Because if something has been mutated, it has lost its activity to do its normal function. So in normal way, the normal function of this EIN2 was the C end of the EIN2 was supposed to make a stabilization of a EIN3, which is our transcription factor. And as a result, the transcription factor is going to help in the overall transcription activation. But as because the EIN2 is now mutated, so there will be no one to stabilize the EIN3. So there will be a no transcription of the ethylene responsive gene, as well as there will be the no response, no function that was supposed to be mediated by the overall signaling pathway. So with this explanation, we can easily able to eliminate the D statement. So in this way, the correct answer for this question will be the second answer, that is the B, and the C statement is the correct one. With this, we have completed the portion of our ethylene signaling, and in this way, we have completed the whole series of ethylenes too. I hope this video was helpful for you. If you like this video, then do like it by giving a thumbs up and make sure to subscribe this Teaching Paathshala channel. Thank you for watching this video.